of honoring filmmakers that continuously work on expanding the very meaning of cinema through their form, through their stories, through their continuous work, and through their sheer power of personality. And we have one such person with us today. Her name is Claire Denis, but you knew that. And we will take the time to talk to her, and we found a very warm person to speak to her this afternoon, the former director of International Film Festival Rotterdam. So give a very, very warm round of applause to both Simon Field and the guest of honor, Claire Denis.
Welcome, everybody. How to begin, I think, is the question, or perhaps I don't need to begin, because I think probably everybody here is pretty familiar with Claire's work. One of the things that gives me great pleasure to be here in the seat, apart from admiring her work very highly, is that she has been coming to the festival since the very beginning and was talking earlier about the years of Huber Bals, when the guests were put up on a ship in the river and the situation was enormously different from the way it is now. When I arrived here, there was a sort of not necessarily a realistic sense of the past, in which was like a shadow. Huber was like a shadow. But it's wonderful in the way that the festival continues the spirits of Huber. And in that sense, welcoming Claire here today is very special, because she's been somebody who has been at the festival many times since those first years. She was on the jury, I think, maybe during my years. I'm not quite
sure. Yes, during your years, yes. Yeah.
And she misbehaved a bit, actually, but I won't talk about that. What I'd like to do today is talk, obviously, about High Life, which I imagine many of you've seen this afternoon or have seen it already previously. But I'd like to also digress a little bit through some of the earlier films and looking at a number of aspects of her work. I thought the best way to start would actually be at the beginning of High Rise, and show a long clip from the very beginning to set the scene of the film, but also because the film is in many ways so rich, there are so many things to talk about, that I think we can actually take that clip as a very good starting point. So this is the first 5 minutes of the film as a clip.
I will be able to say a few words before. I would like to say good afternoon, and I'm not very, it's not easy for me to be able to express personal things in English. I will do my best. I would like also to say thank you to Simon. And it's a big thing for me to be moderated by him. And I remember I was here in Rotterdam for the party of your departure, with all the little films that were screened. And this is something I never forget. And it was not a sad departure, because you were living to be a producer, to have daring film existing. Thank you.
Thank you. So, before I get too emotional, let's have a look at the clip.
Thank you. Mommy, honey. What you doing, Lola? What you doing, Willow?
I wanted to use that clip because I thought those of you who've seen the film are reminded. Those of you that haven't seen the film already get a very strong sense of it without my giving away any of the key things that happen in the film. But also that it already sets up a very characteristic rhythm, coloring, tone, use of sound. So many of the characteristics that follow through in the film. The use of the body, which I would like to talk about later, the body in space, the body in architecture. But Claire, I'd like to ask you just, one of the things that struck me looking back at some of your films, and I'm thinking particularly, for instance, of Les Salauds, your beginnings are always very strong. But they're also very ambiguous, so you never know what the time is, or it becomes clear that you don't know what the time is later. And I wondered if you could say about that, a little bit about this as a beginning.
Yes. First of all, I would like to say that by watching those images, I realized how lucky we were to find, to have this little girl so great. And Robert Pattinson was so inside the project, so trustful, you know, it's touching. And also I'm touched by the importance of the music composed by Stuart Staple, the musician with whom I work for 20 years now. The strange thing with this film is I always thought the film was going to start by, not the end, but let's say not the very beginning of the story. I wanted to be in this far away from the solar system, in an old, rusty ship, looking like a jail, with this baby and this man, as if it was already almost the end of a story and not the very beginning. And I thought it was very important to start like that, because this was the precious, precious idea of the film. This man alone, in fact, he had no reason to stay on board. And the only reason he's on board is he has a baby to take care of. He's responsible for this life. That's why I always wanted to start like that, and not in a chronological order.
One of the things that strikes one immediately is the intensity of the green. And I'd like to talk later about color in the film, but one of the things that you set up very quickly is this strange, intense garden, followed by a very quick portrait of the nature of the ship. Mm. And in fact, it turns out that your whole presentation of the ship and the environment is in many ways very abstract and very done with very few key scenes. But why did you begin with that intense green?
I thought the only thing growing apart from the baby was this garden. It's the most precious. It's like the oasis of this spaceship. It's like the place where something that it's still earthen is still alive, and so alive by growing, but also by the color of a garden, you know, of the yellow, the green. I've been reading a lot about space, and I realized by reading that it's very important for the space program that are studied now today to have this, to be able to grow plant and vegetable and fruit, something fresh, something growing, you know, not only dried powders, you know. And I realize this little soil, this little mist falling on the leaf is going to be the only, it's like a sort of small paradise in that ship, you know? Like the paradise of Eden, like in the Bible.
Let's talk a little bit about the ship, because one of the things that sequence does as well is introduce the audience to the nature of the ship and the design of it and the design of their suits. And since most of us are very used to very high-tech Hollywood versions of space suits and everything else, it looks very I can't quite think of what the word would be to describe the nature of the suits, the nature of the when they're coming into that little area.
Yeah.
The way it's all made is very, and the little baby's cot is put together with bits and pieces. So the whole feeling of the is of a sort of cupboard that's flying through space.
Yeah, I think it was a jail sent to space outside a solar system, which means it takes a lot of time already to get there. It takes those, this man there is not new in space. It's been there maybe for 5 or 6 years already, you know? So there is a sort of half abandoned place, you know? He's alone there with the baby, and we will realize that his companion are no more there. And I think I wanted to say, in this condition, going to be sent in space, it is not to be a soldier of the force, to be splendid white knight, you know. It's actually we copy the space costume. We copy the Russian cosmonaut costume, which are in a way. Maybe they look dull, but they're also high-tech, you know, in a way. They are not so out of fashion. They have something. They still exist, you know. And I saw the ship. I wanted the ship to look like a jail. No more than that, you know. And I remember when I was in the Space Center in Köln, in Germany, it's a place where they train cosmonauts. And after the cosmonauts have spent 2 or 3 months in space, they rehabilitate them to, because when they get back from there, their muscle, their bone, their eyes, everything is very, it's not an easy thing. Yeah? They have to recuperate. And in that place, I was surprised because in the copy of the space station and the many equipment were Russian because it's part American, Russian, European, and there was this old computer. And I said, wow, this computer looks like in the 80s. And this Russian guy was there and he said, yeah, but it's... it's so solid, we don't want to change. Ah, I say, yeah. You know, there was something almost reassuring that time was already part of the trip. Yeah.
Could you say a little bit about the origins of the project? I mean, this is a film which is on a financial scale, which is considerably greater, I think, than
yeah.
your other films. Obviously with rather expensive actors, shall we say, or more expensive actors. I mean, how...
Or
how
very generous.
Or
actor.
Very generous.
I have to...
Yes, I know about
that,
too.
That's the way.
yes, I have a case in mind at the moment. How did you, I mean, is it something you'd been nurturing for many years? Or how did it, I mean, and also I'd like to mention, I mean, perhaps you can bring him into the discussion. There are several people who you've worked with many times over a series of, you almost, it's like you have a collective. And one of them is Jean-Paul Favreau.
Sure, yes, yeah. The scriptwriter.
The scriptwriter.
Yeah.
So I was interested to see how that's...
This script we wrote a long time ago when an English producer wanted to know if I felt like able to do a film, English-speaking film. And I told him maybe yes, if it does not take place in a place where I could do a film in French, you know, it has to be somewhere. And I told him as a joke, in space, for instance, there is only two languages, Russian or English, you know, American. And it was like a joke, but then in the end, he said, oh, really? But because I wanted to propose you a story, a love story like Femme Fatale. And I said, well, maybe Femme Fatale in space, you know? And that's why that little girl is a femme fatale, actually, for me, you know? And that's how it started. But this was like 7 or 8 years ago. And it took us a long time not to cast the film. The actor were already, all actors were interested immediately, but it was difficult. Apart from the German co-producer who already offered us the studio in Köln and a great co-production, money was missing. And it took us a few years to reach a complete budget, which was not so big, but five producers together. And great actor and actresses who were, as I say, very generous with their time.
Could you say a little bit about the casting? I mean, I wanted to talk later on about, well, actually with showing another clip, about the way you have a particular way of looking at faces and looking at bodies. So I'm curious about the casting.
When we first wrote the script, I thought the main character, for me, should be a man in his 40s. He was sent there with the other as a convict. He was in the death row. And he has no hope. He accepts the trip just as a diversion, not to stay in the death row, but it's not a very optimistic moment for him. He believes it's a different way of dying, you know. And I thought I had in mind someone tired of my life, and I thought someone, it's terrible to say that, I thought of Philip Seymour Hoffman. And then, sadly enough, he was tired of life for sure, and he died. And then my agent and the casting director told me, Claire, I really want you to be good with a young actor who wants to meet you. I know he's not the right for you, but you have to meet him. It's Robert Pattinson. And I said, but he's much too young. It's much too iconic, you know. It's not possible. And then, as we were waiting and waiting for the money to be raised, Robert kept coming visit me in Paris and says, I'm getting older every month. So in the end, you will accept me, you know. And when we get the money, I said, Robert, maybe you're still too young, maybe you're still too iconic, but without you, I can't make the film without you for sure, yeah.
But I'm curious about how somebody like that, who's used to working in, shall we say, in the Hollywood context, in films that are full of dialogue,
and whatever,
and how did he respond to your particular way of dealing? Because it's not a dialogue-heavy film at all.
I was completely surprised. I thought the first day of shooting, I thought he was going to be so. I'm not an improvising director. I like when it's settled. But I am very tactile. I do things myself, you know. I need to be part of everything, you know. And I realize his interest in filmmaking is so great, so real, that he was ready for everything I proposed, you know. Nothing, he was the most easy actor I work with, you know. And he became almost like, it was like a brotherhood, something. When I think of him, I know how much I want to work with him once more. You know, it's a meeting very important. Same like Juliette Binoche. You know, people who get so involved, they are not afraid. They are not afraid to be maybe in a project, a weird project maybe. They have no fear.
Well, that's very apparent with Juliette Binoche in this film, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Could you, something you said I'd like to follow up on there. You said that you get very involved in, you know, presumably you have a quite detailed script, but then you said you get very involved in the mise-en-scène. And,
yeah.
And I'm curious because one of the things that I feel very strongly with him as well, but with other actors, and I've seen it in other films, is there's a sort of choreography where you are actually, I mean, he does all sorts of things with his arms and...
yeah.
And I wondered if that's what you meant in a way about how you direct in that situation.
When he did this with his arm at the end, I think it was like he was so afraid at that moment that he didn't know how to answer his daughter, you know. It was sort of a natural gesture he had to avoid to say the word, maybe we are going to die, you know. But Robert became so involved in the film, he knew exactly, me, maybe I'm doing this thing too when I'm directing, I don't know. When I say I'm tactile, I'm not asking actors, actress to move in a certain way. We speak about it and we find the mood, we find the rhythm and the choreograph is the camera, I guess. Yeah, to be able to caress and to be close and respectful, but to be together. The togetherness with the actors, for me, it's the only really moving thing. Even if I decide a large shot and the character is far in a long corridor or whatever, in a distance, then the momentum on staying there in a static shot, it's also a sort of choreographic shot, because the duration, the time, staying there, looking statically at someone means also to be together with, you know? You know? I don't think I use the camera to judge, never, but to be a companion, always.
One of the things that you mentioned then is these long shots down corridors. And one of the interesting things, again, about the, I'm thinking of the beginning of Les Salauds, is the man who's about to kill himself. He's in a sort of medium shot. But I think it happens in other places where somebody sort of disappears behind the architecture. And in this film, there's a sort of choreographic relationship between empty space and a person in it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very striking, and you can see it already in this scene, mm-hmm. That the corridor is empty, then the sound comes of the child. But there's a sort of, and the shot, the location at the bottom of the ladder is something that is sometimes empty, sometimes full. Mm-mm-mm. I mean, you use empty space as against...
Sure. With the I must say, I've been watching film, and... a prison film also, and I realize by reading book too, a prison is architecture is very special, and a corridor in a jail is a sort of how do you call this bone
backbone.
It's like the
spine, yes.
It's the spine of the jail, building, you know. The corridor is something you have cell on, but the corridor is a way where the guard could walk, you know. It's very important. And I start thinking of the shape by the corridor and then the lower space. For me, it was already my way to remember what a jail looked like, you know, even in space.
Speaking of jail films, one of the things that's very interesting about, well, this film, whether it's a jail film or a space opera, but is genre is something you always play with. And I thought it might be nice, actually I chose it for other reasons, to go back a little bit to one of your most controversial films, Trouble Every Day.
Oui.
which
if
seeing
you dare
it
to,
well, I'm taking a rather safe scene. So, as you'll see, it's a safe scene, but already there's been some trouble every day. So, so what I wanted to do was raise this the idea of the fact that in both cases you're reworking a genre, in that case horror film. But I also wanted to use this clip because of your attention to faces with the camera, but also because of the use of, he's not really a Hollywood actor, but an actor who is very well known and fits this case, it's Vincent Gallo. But this is the very big early part of the film where Beatrice Dahl has just eaten somebody's neck. And she's with another regular actor of yours, Alex Descas, mm-hmm. Who is really part of your troupe of
sure.
actors. And then it runs into Gallo. And I think the way this scene is constructed is exemplary because it uses his face, his look, but also intimates where we're going to go in the film. So if we could have the little clip from Trouble Every Day, please.
Those lights are Denver.
Yeah, it's so geometrical. It's like a computer chip.
To Mr. and Mrs. Brown. I'm happy. Are you happy?
Thank you.
What I like about that clip as well is the last shot of the three men sleeping in the one with the mask over his, which made me
something think, we experience in a plane, huh?
Of course, but it looks very surreal and
yeah, terrifying.
For me, I was thinking also in quite a lot in your films. Often there are shots that come in, like the shot, for instance, in the opening sequence where there's this glove floating in space, where you work with the rhythm of the sequence by introducing something completely, not completely extraneous, but that changes one's perspective on the material.
Yeah.
But I was curious here to
I realized because you choose that clip that it was so strange, like almost automatically, the couple on Earth, the couple interpreted by Alex Descasse and Beatrice Dalle, are in a sort of hell, inferno. It's night on Earth, and she just killed a man, and he's trying to take her home, to protect her. But of course, he knows she's lost. Huh? And suddenly, in a sort of paradise, in a plane, this young couple in love, I mean, this couple watching, I mean, drinking champagne, and then as if it was opposed. Of course, the character interpreted by Vincent Gallo knows he's also going to inferno, but he's not sure yet, he's hoping not. But then the large shot of the people sleeping in the plane is already like a sort of a terrible place where people are sleeping with open mouths, you know? Like something bad is going to happen.
Well, they're like the dead in a way.
Yeah.
But it's so extraordinary, I think, the way there's just the first shot when Gallo, and not the first shot, but the shot when after they've been drinking the champagne and looking at each other, he looks at her, and already it looks as if he has two minds. And then the kissing, which actually, I know, introduces the idea that he might eat her arm as well.
Mm. I think Vincent is such a great intelligent guy, is also a great director, and he knew so well. It was not difficult to tell him what to do. You know, it was like we were at such close range in a plane, you know. There is such an intimacy, you know, by filming them as if they were alone in that plane, not paying attention to the other. I think, yeah, with Vincent, I think it's been easy. I have to say, Vincent, I met him before he was an actor. I met him before. I made a short film with him in New York a long time ago, and I was amazed by his how would I say, the way he incarnates, the way he's alive in the image, you know, is very fascinating.
But is that, that's one of the things that I think is, we'll maybe go and take a look at Michel Sabor later on, but there are people with extraordinary faces in your films. I mean, like Gallo.
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems to me often that you've chosen people with... Mm. I mean, Patterson actually is, except in this film, he's sometimes got that sort of conventional young Hollywood look, but you do a lot of work with
him. He was never completely conventional, I have to say. Yeah. Even when I saw Twilight, this young couple, both of them, I was watching Twilight and I thought, wow. Now, this is a teenage movie, but those young people, they look so intense, so mysterious, you know? There was something in both of them, as if they were lending their beauty to the film, but inside them, there was something else, another wish, you know, that attracted me already, you know?
One of the things that...
Do you agree?
Of course.
Oh. And you agree too? Yeah, okay.
One of the things that Trouble Every Day evoked, obviously, was the question of taboo and the relationship with the body, between bodies, sexuality and the body. And that we can use that to lead us back to the first extended dialogue in High Rise, which other people have commented on it, which is taboo. And both films share this complex presentation of relationships between, obviously partly sexual, but also in relation to the body itself and the way that Juliette Binoche, for instance, not only turns into a sort of dervish and an extraordinary thing, but also the way that the whole...
She inseminate.
Yes, the whole sexual relationships are so varied. And often, again, it touches on something that is very striking about your films, is there's a constant sort of contrast between tenderness and violence.
Yeah.
And that comes up in this film, the very extreme violence, but at other moments, great tenderness.
Yeah, I would not say no. I have to agree with you. And yet, I'm not sure I understand so well exactly how this combination came so often in my mind. When I'm writing a script, I think I always thought since I was a teenager that there was something taboo in films. Films were showing me the secret of life, always. When I was 13, 14, the sex, the desire, the sex relation, even if they are not completely visible in films, they are there. They are the tension of the film, you know, and the violence too, you know. I probably killing. Killing. The first time I saw killing was in a film, you know. All this is. Film is made of that. I remember, of course. It's not strange that a great German director made a film called Taboo. Huh? It's natural, I guess, you know? In a paradise island, a taboo.
But you take, I mean, one of the things that a characteristic of both those films.
I mean, Murnau. Yeah, I'm sorry to.
To yeah, not. Go,
no, no, much. I know, you know.
One of the things that you do is you break, in a way, visual taboos, or you push towards with visions of the body or actions, or in the case of Trouble Every Day, an extreme disfiguring of the body. But you often actually break a taboo of cinema, in a way, of what is conventionally allowed to be shown. Or do you think I exaggerate?
There is the idea in the film that the taboo is going to be broken, is about to be broken, or has been broken. But it's not really shown in the film. I'm not so exhibitionist. I'm not so keen about sexual exhibition. But the meaning of it, I'm interested. Yeah, yeah, very much so.
Perhaps that's a good point to take another clip, which is the one from Les Salauds, which I wanted to talk about, not only because it's one of the ways you deal so elegantly with an erotic encounter, but also to draw out from you a little bit the way you, the work with rhythm and the work with editing to construct a scene and to fragment and also concentrate on the space, on the face. Because again, this is a scene largely without dialogue. And well, let's see it. So the clip from Les Salauds, please. It's a beautiful scene.
Yeah, beautiful actors too.
Yeah. Could you say a little bit about the way, I mean, in a way, I think it refers to all your films, but the way... Well, it's also very interesting, actually, to hear the sound as well, the way the music is related to sound, and and you've mentioned already that you work constantly with Stuart Staples and more and more. But I was interested in this particular case of the way that you've... I mean, there's a wonderful way, and it's something that also is echoed in High Rise and in other films, of using the hands or parts of the body or even the her full body, which is a way of almost... Well, the camera caresses the body, basically. Mm. But there's a lovely choreography of the way you use the hand against his wounded hand.
Yeah.
And whether this is... Do you construct a scene like that in the editing, or do you conceive of it already when you're shooting?
No, I knew when I did location scouting that it was written in the staircase, but then as I was doing location scouting, I found out these staircases are like that, you know, and the light should be like that and like that. And I work with Agnes, and I know I sort of decide not to do it in a sequence shot, one sequence shot. It could have been done. But because they were in that staircase and with this time seeing that the babysitter was behind the door waiting to go, I thought maybe it's better if I do it step by step, as if the time was counted. And also the music of start, the rhythm of the music is like this thing on the piano, you know, like a clock thing, you know. So I thought sequence shot is not right for that. It has to be piece by piece, moment by moment, you know. And it starts when she takes off her shoes in a staircase, in a way. It's as if by walking on a naked sheet, she already started undress.
And that was with Agnès Godard,
who
you've worked with many times.
Not in the last film, because Agnès, we had done the film before, and she... It was too close for her, too. She needed.
Yeah, one of the reasons I started that clip when I did was it gave us a brief view of Michel Subor.
Yes,
who was in The Intruder and in other films of yours. And, I mean, he's, for me, one of those examples of one of your regular actors who are very different from film to film, like Alex Descas, but have a sort... I mean, he's the most extraordinary-looking person. And not at all... like he was when he was a young man in Godard.
No. But I must say, when I saw him in a Godard film he made, Le Petit Soldat, it was a very strong film already, because it was... Not only it was stopped by censorship. We couldn't see the film immediately. We have to wait to see the film, because it was about Algerian war. And the character played by Michel Subor was a sort of defeated young man, a guy, as he say, with no ideal, a young man with no ideal, running away from the French army and ready to kill someone for money and to escape, you know. Someone with no moral, no ideal. And it is this voiceover. And the voiceover... and the face of Michel already struck me as a sort of very Romanesque and desperate figure of non-heroic, you know, as opposed to Jean-Paul Belmondo in Breathless. Michel was a... Michel Subor, for me, represent a guy from the dark side of the moon. You know, he's Russian. He came in France when he was a child, and he's still today, he's 80, and he's a, I think I have a project with him. I don't know, it's such a, he's completely apart from everyone I've met.
And you, I mean, he's the centerpiece of one of your films, The Intruder L'Intrus.
Yeah, yeah.
But he appears in others. But let's talk about another actor a little bit, and I can't resist showing this scene because I like it so much. When this is, you talked earlier about Juliette Binoche, and I took a scene from Let the Sunshine In because I thought we could use it to get back to High Rise, but also because, well, there's several reasons, one of which is, it's an example of the way you use music and whole songs sometimes. I resisted the temptation to show that marvelous last sequence in Beau Travail, which everybody, I hope, knows by heart.
Rhythm of the Night.
Yeah. And this, I wanted this because of the difference of her in this film and her in High Rise. The way in which you work with actors with quite often extraordinary faces and features, and also the way that, again, choreography of camera, the way that in this sequence, the person she's about to appear, or about to meet, appears. And this is one of several men, which it's not quite clear in the film, which we haven't talked about yet, actually, the question of chronology and time structure. But she has encounters with several different men, and this is one of the, comes last in the film, but it's a wonderful piece of music and choreography as well. So Let the Sunshine In, please.
Tu viens avec moi?
J'arrive.
In heaven. pense bien.
That's how it's done.
So great to fall in love with a beautiful song.
No, it's a beautiful sequence. And it takes us back to...
I have to say, you mentioned the choreography, speaking about this scene. And they were... Juliette can dance pretty well, and Paul too. But the most magic ballet movement was the camera. Really, I was watching the dolly and Agnès, I was amazed, you know. And the focus puller, great. Oh, so great.
No, because I suddenly thought, you know, in the way that sequence is, the timing of it, the way she goes to sit down, and the movements and grace. It was like a Stanley Donen film, you know, it's really beautiful. And she is so, I mean, I wanted to make the contrast because I think you said somewhere in an interview that you were very hesitant about working with her so soon on High Rise.
High Life.
High Life, sorry.
Sorry.
High Rise is another film altogether.
No, it's not. I was hesitant when we wrote Le Beau Soleil Intérieur, Let the Sunshine In. I had no idea, and Juliette wanted to be in the film, and I realized she was right. She was the one, you know, and I don't know why it was so great. She said, "It's me," and I have to do it. And I said, yeah, you're right. I don't know. I thought, ooh. Because in the process of writing, me and my co-writer, it was so much about the disaster of love stories for a woman that we saw each other. You know, we were inside the film. And suddenly, here comes Juliette, the beautiful Juliette. And she said, me. And suddenly it was strong. And then when I did High Life, I wanted Patricia Arquette to be the doctor. But then because of the postponing of the schedule of the time, Patricia had to be on a TV program, and I couldn't be in Germany with us. And Juliette, we just finished this film, she says, oh, maybe we can do it together, you know? And it was so easy, so simple.
We have got two roving microphones, so I think it's time to open it up to you for some questions. So, I mean, I think we can see from here, so if anybody would like to kick off with a question, raise your hand and please let the mic come to you before you... Nobody. Ah, there's one here and then a second one there. But yeah.
There's one here?
Yeah.
Thanks. I love your movie Intruder. I got really impressed.
Yeah.
And I know that it's an sort of adaptation based on Jean-Luc Nancy's book. And you talked about the correlation between wound and please. Mm. And as you know, in the book, Nancy talks about it. And you personally express your actually interest about it. How was it? It was primarily defined, or it was something you, together with Nancy, actually came to the conclusion to make it like this?
I have to be very honest and to say I was maybe slightly crazy when I thought, as I was reading that book, very short book, you know, about his heart transplant. And I was reading it one night and I thought, I have to make, to adapt this, it's a film for me. And Jean-Luc Nancy, I told him, and he said, but then it's a documentary with me. And I said, no, it's going to be fiction. And he was amazed. He didn't believe, you know. And then we made the film. I thanks to a great producer that you know, Albert Balzan, who sadly died, and Amber, we went, we almost crossed the world with that film, you know, and with Michel Subor, and it was as if we had written a script with Jean-Paul, but it was as if I was translating Jean-Luc Nancy's impression of being transplanted, you know? It was fascinating. And then when the film was finished, Jean-Luc Nancy said, but this is not at all my book, you know? And I said, yes, it's your book in a way. And then he came a second time to watch the film and said, oh yeah, it's true, it's not an adaptation. You adopt the book. I don't know, it's true. In a way, I did. I think I was probably partly crazy when I thought it was possible to adapt this book. But I thought I was very close to the book, detail by detail, you know.
There's another question here, yes. In the front row.
Is it a good answer for you? Okay.
Hi. I saw High Life last night, and I have to say thank you. I really, really loved it. I noticed in the credits that you thanked, or you had worked at some point with Olafur Eliasson.
Yeah.
I wonder how that, what his involvement was.
Oh, this English producer who is the initiator of the Oliver Dungey of the film, one day he told me he knew Olafur, and he said, let's go, because I was telling him that I've seen this exhibition in London, The Sun Rise by Olafur, and he said, let's go and meet him in Denmark. We met him. I told him about the project, and during 5 years we were discussing about cosmos, black hole, black matter, things like that. In fact, Olafur would have loved to do, he would have loved me to shoot in his own place, in his factory. He thought it was stupid to go to a film studio. But I had to tell him I needed a sort of film organization. But he was always there. And what I, what inspired me most in for the film was this golden yellow light he invented. And for me, this was the what you could find if you go inside a black hole. It's a sort of because this light is very extraordinary. When you put human skin in this light, it loses the color of skin. It becomes like bronze, you know. And I thought it was a transformation, almost a chemical transformation. That's why the end of the film we shot not on digital, but on film, to get this thing, this effect.
When it opens up to be completely white, yeah, which is really beautiful. Mm. Could you say a little bit more following up on that? I mean, was he part of the proposing of the way in which you use color throughout the film, actually, not just in the spatial things, but in the shifts between blue and orange and within the actual ship itself, which seems not arbitrary, but something that is...
It was more red, a sort of red that would pass away than an orange. I didn't want the uniform of prisoner look like Guantanamo. So we invent a sort of reddish uniform for the prisoner. And I thought, when I see science fiction movie today, it's very shiny, whitish, and I think it's give the idea of a pure purity, conquest, glory. And I wanted a darker hue. A semi-shadow, you know? So I wanted color, beige in the corridor. We never use white, in fact, except at the end.
Other questions? One right at the back there, please.
Hi, thanks so much for being here. I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you see the role of violence in storytelling, or what is your relationship to the depiction of specifically sexual violence in the case of High Life, to how you see that as a part of storytelling, or why you see that as an important part of in a cinematic representation to tell a story with kind of like a really graphic depiction of violence.
I think it became from two main ideas. One idea is jail. People in jail, they have a violent relation to sex, because sex is not allowed, you know, in a way, normal sex. So apart from masturbation or rape, you know. That's for jail. And then I saw the main character is a guy who decide not to be away from that, not to masturbate, not to have sex relation, not to go to the so-called fuck box, as we call it on set. So I thought it would not, all this frustration they had in them, would lead them to a certain type of violence, except the main character was exactly the opposite. He had decided to save a freedom in him, to keep away from that. And I remember, I don't know if you read those tales of the knight in the Middle Age, you know, Lancelot and... how do you call this legend of the? Yeah, Lancelot. They needed to be good knight. Needed to be pure, and chaste. Mm. Not, chastity always has a meaning. You have frustration on one side. That leads to violence, and chastity, that is a sort of strange movement of protecting, of protection. I don't know, it's very intriguing for me, you know? What brings chastity to a knight, a soldier, a jail, a prisoner, you know? Is it purity? Is it a different traits? A way to resist expulsion? I don't know. It's interesting for me. And the violence is, of course, the raping scene in High Life was really this young man could not take it anymore, you know. I think it's almost a like jumping in the void, you know. Okay, I'm doing it, you know. Like the doctor is jumping in the void. Something, there is a sort of, in this violence, a sort of suicidal tendency, you know, in that violence. It's not sexual, it's... it's morbid, maybe. I'm not sure my English vocabulary is rich enough to answer such question, but I hope I did.
Did she?
Yeah.
Okay.
One thing that we haven't touched on, and I can't resist asking you about, because it's present in High Life, but it's also present in so many of your other films, is the way that you structure a story. I mean, here it becomes involved with different ideas about time, but at the same time, it's so often in your films a sort of puzzle is the wrong word, enigma. There's things we don't know about people we see, and we don't know it until quite late. For instance, in High Life, you don't really know, well, who's the daughter, which one. I mean, it's, but you do that again and again in the films as a sort, almost like a principle of constructing a story and working with time and the audience.
I have to, not to contradict you, but just to be very honest with you and with you, I have not a plan when I start a script to confuse people or to build a sort of labyrinthic story. I am so... it's as if I believe in what came first to my mind. What came first was, in this example, father, man and baby, a man and baby. And little by little, you will understand he is a father, you know? And for me, it was not a trick. And I am not a tricky person, and I regret it sometime. I would love to be more tricky. But it's a very natural way of putting things together, you know? Maybe I'm too chaotic to build a story normally, you know?
I mean, I certainly didn't feel me.
I am honest.
Because I don't think it's tricky. For me, it's one of the great strengths of the film, of the films, is that you have an... for instance, again, it's still very much in my mind, from seeing the Les Salaux and the beginning of the film, you don't really know what the man who's actually committed... So you can't be clear whether it is. There's this extraordinary shot of a largely naked woman walking in the street, and you don't know what's happened to her, and you don't really know until the end of the film. Mm. But it has, because of the way you film it, the way the sound works, it has an extraordinary strength. So that actually, in High Life, that's the case too. The things that you don't know, some things get revealed rather quickly, like the fact that he killed the little girl and things. But other things become very not unclear, but become you become absorbed because you don't quite know what's.
You know, when you mentioned Les Salaux, I have to tell you, it's I love to read newspaper. To read stories in newspaper, and once I heard, it's a woman I knew well. She had a daughter of maybe 18 or 19, who the mother didn't know exactly, but she knew her daughter was having a sort of chaotic use, you know, going out late, maybe taking drugs. And one night, the police called her. They had found a daughter walking in the street of Paris, naked, on high heels, and falling near the garbage truck, you know? And I could imagine a mother, to go through that, you know? She take her daughter, put her in a hospital, of course, you know, and then save her daughter, but it took time. But I thought, wow, life can be that hard on someone, you know, and also on a young girl. She was going to parties, being drugged, you know. I thought, oh my God, this is true. And that's how the story started, you know. In life, if you read newspaper, you read things. Oh, it's like you feel life. Real life is so cruel, so obscene. You know. So this image, when she told me the police find her daughter walking naked at night in a street on high heels with blood all over her. This image was stuck in my mind forever.
Well, it's stuck in mine too. Mm. Any last questions? We have a last moment. Yes, there, please, in the front row. A modestly raised hand.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for listening.
What draws you to a character when you're developing a project? What catches your eye up to, you know, there's many different types of people that can be made into films. What is it maybe for you that attracts your attention or catches you?
Sometimes you see that just what I mentioned, you know, this story. Then I realize this young woman, she had a mother, she had a father. She was not abandoned by life, you know. She could have had a good life, you know. But, and I try to imagine what it's around. But normally, what attracts me in a character is something that for some reason is close to my own emotion. I cannot invent completely a character, male or female, adult or child, that I have absolutely no relation with. At least I must feel like most of the character. I don't think there is in my film a character that I can say, oh, such a piece of shit, this person, you know? No, I would never do that, you know? It's someone I could feel for, someone I could like, sometimes someone I could love, someone I could cherish, someone I will never judge, someone close. Close not to my real life, but close to my spiritual life or to my dreamy life, you know? I'm a dreamer, you know? And that's what I can say.
Well, perhaps that's a very appropriate moment to thank the dreamer for being here today. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Simon. Thank you very much. Thank you all. In those occasions, I always wish my English would be more fluent, but I did my best.
It was fine.
Thank you.